But as I said that, and I said it more and more, I heard the Spirit say, use what you got. If we use the word of God that He has deposited in us, that'll be enough. You'll get more. If you ain't doing nothing with what you got, you're going to do the same thing with more. Use what you got. I said, okay, Lord. Now that's what He said to me. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 I feel good every Sunday. I'm feeling extra good today. Amen. Amen. Some of you all thought I got wore out with all that praise and time and what a short message today. There's a word that is found in the Gospel according to St. Matthew's, the 21st chapter, beginning at that 8th verse. Matthew's, the 21st chapter, beginning at the 8th verse. It reads, and the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them, and brought the ass and the coat, and put on them their clothes, and they set him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strung them in the way. And the multitude that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he was come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? And the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. And Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out them that sold and bought in the temple and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves, and said unto them, it is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. And the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. And when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were sore displeased. Amen. You may be seated. Our text is coming from that 12th verse. And Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all them that sold and bought in the temple, and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. We like to use as a thought today, Jesus came to get the Father's house in order. Jesus came from heaven to earth, born as a baby, unto Mary. Came to get the Father's house in order. This being the week before the resurrection Sunday, week before Easter. And Jesus made his triumph entry into the city. It was during the Passover time. Many folks were there for that particular purpose. And as they been there, they heard that Jesus was in town. The multitude had already begun to gather early in the morning, excited and looking for him who had raised Lazarus from the dead. We find that in the book of John, but he said there were so many people that the Pharisees said, the world is gone after him. There was a crowd of disciples already accompanying him and the pilgrim on their way to the Passover feast who joined the caravan of folks. There were also residents of Bethany and Bethpage who had heard of his presence and the many miracles that he performed. For the miracles from him, he healing the blind eyes and feeding the 5,000, the woman with the issue of blood, and raising Lazarus from the dead, and many other miracles, and folks just wanted to lay eyes upon him and to be in his midst. And those who were already in Jerusalem, citizens and pilgrims and resident folks who were rushing out and searching for him. Just as many of us do today. We are led to imagine an enormous, large crowd of teeming thousands lining the roadway as Christ was held on top of a donkey. Donkeys symbolize the beast of burden. And he began his triumph entry into Jerusalem. Two or more million pilgrims gather in Jerusalem every year for the Passover feast, and thousands upon thousands were stripped church folks believing it is the Messiah. The news began to spread throughout the city and surrounding areas concerning the miracles of Jesus the Christ. The miracles that he had performed. Many of us come to the house of the Lord not really knowing the Lord. I have met him for ourselves, but we come because of what we have heard. The testimonies that have been shared by those that have encountered him and have witnessed the miracle and the love of him. The very atmosphere was electrified with the exciting news that Jesus was God's promised Messiah. Multitude heard that he was in town. And there was the multitude who had turned around from Jerusalem to go back to meet him. There was the multitude that was already traveling with him, and there was the multitude of citizens in that countryside, Bethany, who had begun gathering around him. Can you imagine all of the folks that was there and looking to meet him? The whole crux of the picture points to the thousands and thousands searching for the Messiah. Rushing out to welcome him when they had heard that he was coming. There's no difference today that we want to get, we want to know him, we want to see him for ourselves. They received him as king. Are you praying with me? They received him as king, and this is shown by the two acts which were always done for kings entering a city. They stripped off their cloaks and cut down tree branches, and they spread it both on the roadway before him. They wished to honor and pay him homage of a king. They wished to show him that they received him as the promised king of Israel. What a wonderful thing. They received him as Messiah. This is seen when they shout about when he came in. For they shouted out, Hosanna, which means save now, or save we pray. They called him the son of Abraham, which was the title of the Messiah. They shouted out, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. For this means blessed is he who is sent by God to save his people. Blessed is he who is sent with the authority of God on high. Okay. They shouted out, Hosanna in the highest, which means God save, we pray. Thou who art in the highest, save now though him whom you have sent. We as people of God must proclaim as they proclaim our King. He is to be King of our hearts and King of our life, to rule and reign over us. Are you praying with me? What do we mean by King? Well, the people of Christ, they were willing to accept him as an earthly king.
All right.
Are you saying with me? They were willing to accept him what authority and power he would use on their behalf as an earthly king. Are you ready for me?
Yes.
They wanted earthly and material benefit. They wanted to be around the world that had proclaimed and shown evident that he is the Messiah. Just like many of us today, that we want to serve the Lord because of what he can do for us, not for what he has done. How many of us like that today? We want his kingly power, which is needed. We need his kingly power, physical and material. But we want nothing to do with his kingly authority as being Lord over our lives. We must welcome Christ as God, true Messiah, the one who has come to truly save us. But what we mean by save, we need to understand what that is talking about. We should not presume upon his earthly care and deliverance unless we are first willing to receive his spiritual care and deliverance. We must be born again. Salvation and rebirth surrendering of our lives unto him and letting him be Lord over our lives, which indicates that we have a choice to let him rule over us or not. That we ought to have the mind of John. That says the Lord, he said that I must decrease and you must increase. All of us should cry out, Hosanna, Hosanna, save us now. 2 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, the 2nd verse declares, behold, now is the acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. We must make two confessions. Christ is the blessed who come in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Salvation is in the highest. It is in Christ whom God has sent. Make Nathaniel, as he's declared in John, the 1st chapter, the 49th verse, Nathaniel answered and said unto him, Rabbi, thou art the Son of God. Thou art the King of Israel. John 3:16, that familiar passage of scripture that says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. We must lay all that we are, all that we have, all that we hope to be before Christ. Not only our clothes before him, but let's lay our desires and our wants and our hopes and our shortcomings and our mess ups and our downfalls and our setbacks. Let's lay all of those things before him. Let's lay our bad decisions and bad choices and all of the mess ups in our lives and all of the unforgiveness that we have forgave. Let's lay it all before him. And truly, allow him to be Lord over our lives. There was a question of the people in Jerusalem. All the city was moved, shaken. John reported that the world is gone after him. The word, the Roman says that a popular uprising might be in the making. The word didn't look at the miracles that he performed, the good that he had done. The world was looking at self-ambition, self-pride, and arrogance. The Herodians, who were the Jewish ruling party, feared that they would be overthrown and lose their power. The Pharisees were stirred to new depth of envy and malice. The common people were convinced that their day of liberation had finally arrived in Jerusalem of Nazareth. That's the way we are. We ought to look at ourselves as common folks. For the word says not to think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. And I just come to the realization and conclusion when I look at myself and I look at you, that none of us can point our finger at any of us. For we all stand in the sunshine of God's grace for he looked beyond my fault.
Yeah.
And he saw my need. Some of us have a little problem It may be rumbling and complaining. It may be gossiping. A whole host of sins that could be happening. But nothing will keep folks away from the church quicker than sin. No practicing sin in the church.
Learn to stand on the promises of God's word.
see it come to pass. If we learn to hold on when the going get tough. Hold on in the midnight hour. Because of the flesh. Amen. Y'all stay with me now. I may go along with this. Look up the name and say, he almost finished. Yeah. Tell him you really need to hear this last part. Yes, sir. Faith. Sometimes it takes some breaking. Take some shaping, some molding, going through some things to get you out of you and get you into Christ. It takes some trusting. It takes some waiting. Faith is seeing it already happen before it happened. Faith is believing. Now, faith is receiving. Now, it's believing before you receive it. If you believe it, then you receive it. Opposite what the world says. The world says, I receive it, then I'll believe it. That's faith. I mean, that's not faith. That's not faith. I need to back up. I don't want to confuse y'all with this. The world says that in order for me to believe it, I got to receive it. And the Bible says that if you believe it, you already got it.
Go ahead, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Don't care what it looks like. Don't care how you feel about it. That's right, that's the law. Spiritual law. You know what the law is? The law says if you go through that red light, you didn't get a ticket. That's the law. I don't care what court you go to, you get the ticket.
Come on, sir. Teach us.
The law. It should be a place where Christ is praised, worship. The religious folks are displeased. These were the chief priests and scribes, those that knew scriptures of the Old Testament. Displeased and object to what they see in him. They do not like the wonderful things being done in the temple. The enemy don't want wonderful things happening in the temple. They don't want folks in the temple praising God. They try to make the believers foolish. It doesn't take all of that. They are angry. It's their own establishment and procedures of handling things had been disrupted in the mind declared no good or else less good than what they should be. They didn't like Jesus being proclaimed as being the Messiah of God. They don't like the unseemly behavior occurring within the church. Ministering to the needs of common folks. Healing the lame and the blind and teaching folks about Christ. Christ insists that he is to be praised. He simply replies to the objection that they made. Says God himself has taken the mouth of these children and proved and provided and brought forth the praise that you hear. The children were praising God. If you don't do what God has called you to do by way of praise, he'll move you out the way and get somebody else to praise him. The church is to be a place where God's Son, Jesus Christ, is to be praised. Self-examination is called for. Is Christ really praised in our church? Is Christ really acknowledged and proclaimed as the Son of the living God? Children should be encouraged to praise God. Look at how the children were in attendance when Christ taught and ministered. You can find that in Mark 11, chapter 18, verse, Luke the 19, chapter 47, verse. They was welcomed by him and felt comfortable around him. The children ought to have a place in the church. Look at how Christ stood up for the children against the priests, the leaders. The children followed the example of their parents. They had seen and participated with their parents in praising Christ the day before. Now they praise him in their own, on their own, and as they witness his ministry and teaching. Christ said that God himself raised up these children to praise him and his ministry within the church. If a church sees to praise him, the likelihood is that God would raise up another to fill his voices with the praise and ministry of his Son.
Yes.
Jesus came to get the Father's house in order.
Yes.
Now that we've heard what thus saith the Lord, I put to you as Joshua put to the people.
Yeah.
Now, you need to choose this day whom you would serve. Joshua said you can serve the God that your father served on the other side of the flood. Jesus came to get the Father's house in order.
Thank you, Jesus.
This was the Sunday before Easter that he made his triumph entry. This is the Sunday before Easter. Many thousands and thousands was there to see Jesus and to hope that he would fulfill their worldly, materialistic desires. Why are you here today? Are you here to see Jesus for what he can do for you? To fulfill your materialistic desire or your selfish ambition? Or are you here to see the living God? And to say, for God I live, and for God I die. Are you here today to cast all your cares upon him? For you know that he cared for you. Are you here today to say, Lord, I'm yours. Everything I got, everything I'm not, everything I hope to be, try me and see if I can't be completely and truly yours. The decision lies within you. Only you can make the decision. Mama can't do it for you. Daddy can't do it for you. The deacon and the preacher can't do it for you. Your wife can't do it for you. Your husband can't do it for you. It must be done on your own free will. Say, Lord, here I am. Here I am. Today, and as the Holy Spirit has moved upon your heart, don't hesitate. Don't wait. Just come to the altar. Come to the altar. Don't give the enemy time to play time. Don't give the enemy time to allow you to wonder and to think at you when you come today to say yes, Lord. If you're looking for a church home and the Holy Spirit has moved on your heart to unite with this church family, why don't you come? If you're coming desiring special prayer, why don't you come? If you're coming to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, why don't you come? Is there one today to say yes, Lord? It's a decision only you can make. The Holy Spirit, he's the one that speaks to your heart. He's the one that breaks you. He's the one that calls your mind to say, yes, Lord. But we have an enemy right on the other side saying, stay where you are. Not the husband, wife,